So in my original plan, I had plans to go more in detail into some of the analysis. I will go faster, and I'll focus on trying to cover the properties that we prove more than how we prove them. But I want to get to the point. I mean, at the end, I want to show how TLS 1.3 is using HKDF, and you see that basically in one single protocol, basically all the properties that I'm going to claim about HKDF are actually used. But so let's see. So HKDF is this extract then expand design that is based on HMAC, where HMAC is both used as a PRF and as an extractor. So the first stage is the derivation of a key, a pseudorandom key, where HMAC is uses salt. Remember that we are assuming that for the extraction part we have salt, you know, the random seed of extraction, and in some cases we will not have it, and we will set that salt to a constant, usually the just zeros. But so HMAC, the first application is in the functionality of an extractor, and the key, the KPRF, that is extracted is used to key again HMAC, but this time as a PRF, to produce as many keys as necessary, where the keys that are produced are again using HMAC with KPRF in feedback mode. We will not go over this part because this is completely standard. Just in the notation, the first element is the key. Yeah, it's the thing that is XORed with OPAD and iPad. And also the salt is used as the key to the extractor. So note the use of a PRF, HMAC as a PRF, with a random but non-secret key. Yeah, this is a very, very non-standard use of a pseudo-random function. And we want to claim that even though we reveal the key, there is still some extraction properties that we can claim. Now, this is a very modular construction in the sense that, for example, you can use HMAC 512 in this extraction, and the keys you can use it with SHA-256. Usually that will not be the case. Usually you will use the same hash here and here. It's very interesting that our analytical results are much better when you truncate the output, because you get a more gap between entropy and the output. So actually doing HMAC 512 here and 256 here would be very good. So far, I have not been brave enough to try to push that into use, because, you know, I say, okay, let's not exaggerate with the theory. Anyway, context information, I explained that feedback mode for the PRF part, not very interesting. So we can have this theorem saying that if, okay, so all my figures until now had a lowercase f as the compression function and uppercase f as the iterated function. Now it will be a lowercase h for the compression function and uppercase h for the iterated. And maybe at some place we'll have find f. But I think I will try to be consistent from now on that lowercase h is the compression function and the uppercase h is the iterated one. So we have that if the compression function that we use is pseudo-random function, then we have that if they are pseudo-random compression functions, HK, then the iterated one is a PRF, according to the things that I said before. I will not get into the proof of how this is done, because this is a more conventional result. The more interesting thing is that, okay, if that part gives us a PRF, then we are happy about the expand part, but then we have the extract that will do the thing is, if the instantiation of HMAC with the family HK is a secure computational extractor with respect to sources in some family S, then the HKDF is a secure KDF with respect to these sources. Meaning, right, if we is the composition of an extractor with an expansion that is PRF give us a good KDF function. The point, the interesting point here is how do we claim, you know, that actually this HMAC on some family is a good computational extractor. Okay, so question is, what do we know about HMAC being a secure computational extractor? And we will have this. We will ask these questions in many settings. We will ask question about the extractability from a single function, basically as a deterministic extractor, which will basically be built on random oracles or random functions. On we will talk about family function with secret keys, as in the PRF case, with non-secret keys, as in the case of HMAC as an extractor with a random but public seed. And the functionality is a pseudo-random function, extractor, random oracle, and also collision resistance. The reason I stress collision resistance here is because in all the papers related to HKDF, you will never see that we claim that it's collision resistant. It is collision resistant because that comes from the hash function. But we didn't think it was interesting to claim that you need collision resistance for these applications. Now in TLS 1.3, it turns out that actually there is a reason why the keys that are extracted also need to be collision resistant. So I added that as a kind of surprise to myself. But that's not an interesting part here. And the kind of results are, if the compression function has a property A, then HMAC has property A prime. In some cases, it preserves the property, like in the PRF case. In some other cases, it's a variant of the property. And type of properties that we prove is pseudo-random function, delta almost universal, extraction, random oracle. And in most cases, the proof will be for NMAC, not for HMAC. And then we will cheat and say that they are for HMAC. Okay? I mean, we will not cheat. We will have to add that additional property that we said about keying the function through the input and having some related key assumption. Okay, so again, NMAC and HMAC as PRFs, this is something, a result that has been established in different ways through the years, but it's now a kind of standard, so I will not go over it. Now, HMAC as a random oracle. So what we want to say is that if you look at the compression functions as a family of random oracles, then HMAC is also a family of random oracles, okay? And turns out that, in most cases, it is the case, but if you are in a setting where the random oracle is used in such a way that the attacker can choose the keys to the random oracles that are being used, if we think about key random oracles, then actually there are some attacks where the attacker can choose keys in some particular way to break the random oracle property. So I'll give you one example, which is, I mean, obvious example in HMAC. One thing I didn't tell you about HMAC, what happens in HMAC? HMAC can accept keys. Usually it is recommended that HMAC uses keys of the length of the output of the hash function. So if it's SHA-256, you use key of 256 bits. SHA-1, you use keys of 160 bits. But actually, since the key goes into a block, the key can be as long as a block, 512 bits, okay? It's well defined. What happens if you put a key which is beyond 512 bits? Actually, HMAC defines that. You hash the key, and you use the key as your, I mean, the output of the hash as your key. So what happens is actually that there are two different keys. If I give you a key which is longer than 512, 1024 bits, you hash it, and you have a new key. But this means that there are two keys that collide. You know, the key of 1000 bits hash into some value, and that value, these are two keys that output the same function. That contradicts what a modeling of random of a family for random oracles that's supposed to be all the functions to be independent of each other. So there you see something. There is something much more subtle in a work by of Evgeny. Again, I cannot say the authors. Actually, I think I can, but I will not do it just to prove that to be equal opportunity, so no one is offended. But anyway, it doesn't matter what exactly. It's a technicality, and actually, it's not very exploitable, but it's interesting. But someone asked before about if there. You asked about if there are examples where playing with the salt or right, or the salt not being chosen independently of the source is a problem. So this can be an example. Now, one nice thing about theory is that when, you know, when I was specifying the things, I always said you either have pure something which is really random as a seed, or if not, you fix it to zero. I wanted to not to leave any choice to attackers to do the things, even though I didn't know about this result. The result came after that. But that's a nice thing about, you know, at least theory as an inspiration. I knew that seeds should not be chosen as, you know, after seeing the source, okay? So either you have it at random independent, or you fix it to zero. So there is no illusion of having a randomness there. Anyway, okay, so that is how you prove HMAC to be a random oracle through the indifferentiability setting, and we will not show. Again, I stole these beautiful slides, so I'm just showing them, but that's it. You saw them. Next. Okay, MAC and HMAC as extractors. So first of all, the first thing is that we take HMAC, we think about them as a PRF, and we use a known key to key these PRFs. What is the strength of PRF when you put a key which is public? What can you say about that? So actually, the intuition of why this thing, even if you know the key, is not that bad is because any observer that doesn't, I mean, any statistical test that doesn't use the key, okay, you know, if you do, you know, you measure zeros against ones, any runs or anything of the output, all these statistical tests that don't use the key, actually, they're fine. I mean, the output is close to indistinguishable or close to uniform in some sense. But if you have a key, then you cannot really claim anything. Now, can you give me examples of a PRF that with a known key becomes distinguishable from random? So you can ask most of my questions. They are written in here. So I'll not show the details of the thing, but I use a quadratic something based on quadratic reciprocity. So I build here a counterexample that uses quadratic reciprocity, a very, very unnatural PRF, but that shows that once it is a PRF, and once I give it with the secret key, once I give you the key, you can distinguish. Okay? Now, it's interesting because we have a result showing that this kind of going to, you know, number theoretic or something type of techniques in showing a counterexample is required. We have some results showing some separation, you know, between one-way functions and I mean, if in mini-crypt, then these things actually exist. So it means that to show a counterexample, you need something that is not in mini-crypt, and this is. Anyway, it's again, I don't want to get into these details now, but there is some interesting thing saying that it's not that easy to build a PRF that when you give the key, actually it's easy to distinguish. So, which is kind of counterintuitive, you know? I mean, you would think that once you give the key, then it should be completely. But the fact that actually it's hard to find that helps us in using this stuff as an extractor. So, so here is one simple example of a type of results that you can get. If you model the compression functions as random oracles, then, and you have a source of mean entropy M, then you can prove that HMAC on such a source is Q times 2 to the minus M indistinguishable from uniform with Q queries, okay? So here you have a deterministic extractor, actually. There is no, well, I mean, this result will also apply even if you fix the functions that you use to building HMAC. Now, you know, even random functions, you know, is a random function a good extractor or not? Is it random?
Yeah.
Huh?
If the source depends on the random oracle, it's not.
So if you take a random function from, let's say, n plus 1 bit strings to n bit strings, is the output close to uniform or not? You have two n elements, you map them into n elements at random. Is the output close to uniform or not? It's not written. It's not written. You will have something like a constant fraction of elements that the function is not going to cover all the elements, right? What will be some 1 over e square of elements that will not get any pre-images, right? You throw 2n elements into n, 2n balls into n bins, okay? So if a constant fraction of the bins will be empty, and that means that it will be far from uniform. So a random function is not a good extractor. However, we are claiming here that actually this is a good extractor, because Q times 2 to the minus M is good. It's basically extracting all the entropy of the source. Now, how is this possible? It's a random function, but it's a random function that we limit the attacker to only look at it in Q different places, okay? And that's the reason that you can do, that you can actually get. That thing, as I said, is balls and bins. Yeah, there is a huge number of things that don't get any pre-image, but to distinguish that, you'll have to work very hard. You have to have an exponential number of queries. But this is a result that is telling you that if you start from a random oracle family of compression functions, then you get a random oracle with this kind of properties, okay? And there is a question about independence of the family and the source with some interesting subtleties, but let me skip that. And basically, the proof is quite immediate. The only way, if you ask the attacker to distinguish an output of the random oracle from uniform, it can only distinguish it if he queried the random oracle on that value. Values that he didn't query are uniformly random. So the only thing it can do in these queue queries is to query the function on the on the heaviest elements in the support, and every element is at, it has a probability of at most 2 to the minus m, because that's the mean entropy. So overall, it can have distinguishing on q elements of 2 minus m probability each one. So this is quite straightforward analysis, but it gives us some meaningful, at least understanding of what the power of the thing is. Then we have the case of extraction from unpredictability. Again, a group in which the CDH, computational Diffie-Hellman, holds, but not the decisional Diffie-Hellman, then we don't have the luxury of using Hill entropy and extracting from that. In this case, you need to output from unpredictability. And again, for that, we can, I mean, if you have, that's one another application of the random oracle, basically, as a hardcore. I have, there is a very interesting story here from my work in the times of IPsec and 20 years ago that shows that these things that we think, okay, independence is, of course, it's a theoretical requirement, but will that happen in practice or not? This is a beautiful example of how things that are, you know, are kill you in theory, also kill you in practice. But you will have to read maybe the slides or the paper or something to see that, or talk to me later. Okay, here actually there is this, you see, at least this time I asked the question before showing the answer. Okay, so this is what I said before. Now, NMAQ is universal function. So a family of function is called, yes. Right.
It's only coming in the level of indistinguishability.
Right.
So it's somehow a combination of things is happening, somehow some extraction, but also some expansion of randomness
right.
that's happening.
Right.
During this computational
setup. Right. So these first of all, these are computational extractors. And in computational extractors, you get expansion for free, right? You extract whatever you extract, and then you can use a pseudo random generator to expand.
Right. So, is apologies if this thing you already talked about. Is there a benefit? I mean, of doing the two-step process versus doing it all at once, or you know, so the two-step is you extract less, but then apply a pseudo random generator. The one-shot thing is like what you described there, where in one shot you get.
Right. So again, so first of all, when you model things with random functions, random oracles, this gives you a lot of power. That lets you do many things that you cannot do with other things. The approach here is let's try to prove as many properties as possible that are being preserved by these modes of operation. Okay. But let's do them with as low assumptions as possible. So if I have an application that I can live without a random oracle, I will try to do that, okay? And I'll maybe show some examples of the thing. So there is the purpose of the thing is proving things. With a random oracle, you can prove almost everything, okay? But we also want to use this approach to in cases where we don't need to actually go, and in these cases you may not get that expansion for free. So that's one theoretical. The answer from the theoretical side. There is an answer from the more practical thing, which I said in the first part that the expansion part, you do it with a PRF as opposed to a pseudo-random generator. And the reason is because you are adding some inputs to that PRF. Context information, domain separation, because you're going to extract, or not extract, but expand more keys than one, and you may want to. So in that sense, you may want also to have this separation. And the nice thing about this stuff is that it works well with the engineering world, because it gives you that modularity that is actually also good for the engineers, or at least those engineers that I can convince that actually it's a good thing to have that. The issues of independence are very interesting. Again, I'll skip them here, just because they're trying to get, just to show you the type of properties that one can prove. So a family of function is called almost universal, or delta almost universal, if for any pair x, y, okay, in the domain of the functions, the probability that you choose a function at random after setting the pair, the probability that this function will send them to the same place is at most delta. Okay, so this is the definition of delta AU. So we can show that if you model if you model NMAC, right? NMAC is you run the cascade and then you apply a function outside. If the outside function is random, you assume it to be random. On the inside, you only assume it to be delta almost universal, then you can show actually something similar to before. You know, we had q times 2 to the minus m closeness or indistinguishability. Now you have to pay with this extra delta coming from the internal function. But now, instead of assuming that the compression function is random, both in the cascade part and in the outside part, we are only assuming the outside function to be random, and the internal thing is a combinatorial property. Okay. By the way, the property of being delta AU is a property that actually follows from these functions being collision resistant, and since these functions were built first and foremost to be collision resistant, I mean, these are the SHA family, MD5 family, whatever family, these were collision resistant, then if there is something you hope that these functions have, that property is collision resistant, and that implies almost universality. Now you can say, if you assume the external function, which is a compression function, to be random, why wouldn't you also assume it for the cascade function? And the answer is yes, actually that's right. But at the same time, you know, again, it's trying to understand which structure are we using here. So it shows that to get basically the benefit of the random oracle, you don't need to assume everything is random. It's enough that you assume the external is random, the internal is almost universal, and the composition gives you something that is basically very close to the same thing that you could get by assuming everything is random. Now, as I said, delta AU is natural assumption for even very, very weak collision resistant catch functions. You can show that if the family H, the cascade, is collision resistant with security delta against linear circuits, then it's delta AU. I mean, you know, very, very, very weak attackers, okay? And if it's collision resistant, then it's delta AU. Why? Because if it's not delta AU, it means that there is a pair that many of the functions send to the same place, and therefore it breaks collision resistance.
If you take any collision resistant hash function and just attach some zeros to the output, it will remain collision resistant. The output from the
why? I mean, putting more zeros doesn't mean that the values will collide.
Oh, okay.
I So say that actually I yeah. So what's the question?
What does this parameter mean?
Which one?
This one.
Delta.
No, the whole square root.
I see what you're saying. this expression closed or indistinguished from uniform. Sorry, that's indistinguishability distance. Which basically comes from the analysis we have for the random oracle, which had Q 2 minus M combined with the leftover hash lemma applied to the delta almost universal. But wait, you had this issue with zeros, is that? Yes. What about that?
This is a self-collision system.
It is collision resistant.
But its output's done
across. Right, right. Collision resistant doesn't imply a random oracle. Yeah, no.
No, compose it. Okay.
Yeah, here there is an application of a random function outside the thing. So actually, you can replace here this delta AU with the assumption that the H family is collision resistant in a very against very weak attackers, which is a very reasonable assumption to have for these functions. Now, what happens if now we assume that the compression function, the family of compression function, is an extractor? Okay, has the properties of a statistical extractor. What do we get then? Ideally, I mean, the result I would like to have is that if the compression function is an extractor family, then the compose, the cascade thing, or the HMAC, NMAC, is also an extractor. Actually, we don't get that, but we get this result, which is, So we need so first of all, remember that I said that the compression functions can also be keyed through the input. Okay, I mean we usually key them through the IV, but they can be keyed through the input. I mean there's the key in the input applied to the IV, which in that case would be the input. I mean, you can reverse the thing. So HK prime will denote exactly the thing. It will denote a function that applies to X as the IV with the key as part of the input block. Okay, so that will be H prime. Okay, so that's one definition. Another definition is what is a K blockwise source. I mean, there are different definitions, but we will mean by this an input, a multi-block input, where every block has, I mean, the total mean entropy will be whatever, but we will ask that every block has mean entropy of k. K is the length of the output, so if 160 bits in SHA-1, so every 512-bit block will have 160 bits of mean entropy. But not just on itself, but conditioned also on following blocks in the input. If you have a situation like that, then we can prove unconditionally. I mean, this is a non-idealized result. I mean, there is no ideal assumptions on anything. In this case, we have that if you assume that HK, the family, is an M delta extractor family, meaning that on sources with mean entropy M, the statistical distance to uniform is delta, and you assume that this dual family H is TQ epsilon pseudo random function, actually even with a single query, then n mac is n delta plus epsilon statistical, this is not statistical because we have a PRF here. So it will be indistinguishable from uniform with these values, time t and epsilon or like that. But assuming the k blockwise source. So this result is interesting because it uses no idealized modeling or assumptions. And at the same time, there is a very practical case in which this applies. In Ike, again, the IPsec exchange protocol, they have different Diffie Hellman groups. In particular, they have groups that use safe primes. Okay, safe prime is where the p is two times, I mean, the prime has the form of 2q plus 1, where q is a prime. Okay, so, and there are the groups like that. And in a group like that, you can actually prove that the conditions hold. Every 512 block actually has, the 160 bit, depending on the, because of these, basically, all these elements have all the entropy. And in particular, they have in every block, even depending on the other one. So one has to look at that more carefully. But it's interesting that you have this result that even though it's asking for things that are not the most common or natural thing, that having this blockwise mean entropy, you can see a practical case. So in Ike, you can say that actually you get a good extraction in provably secure with a PRF and no other computational assumption. Now, if you are willing to truncate the output of NMAC, then which, as I said, if you use as the extractor SHA-512 and output, you take the output of 512 bits of SHA-512 and you truncate to half of it, 256, and use that key to key SHA-256, then you get the benefits of these results, which say that if HK are a family of random functions, and you truncate the k bits of the function to k minus c bits, let's say 512 to 512 minus 256, then you get a closeness to uniform of 2 to the minus c over 2 times some square root n, doesn't matter. But the point here is that if you do what I said from 512 to 256, c over 2 is c is 256, so this is 2 to the minus 128. So if you truncate, you get very strong result. This one is with an idealized assumption of HK being a set of random functions. But we can also get something that is with no ideal assumptions. So if HK is strongly universal with or pairwise independent, and the iterated, the Markel-Damgård is collision resistant against linear size circuits, again, something that we assume these things, if they don't have that property, then forget about these functions, because they will be very bad collision resistant, very non-collision resistant. So HK strongly universal and NMAC truncated by C bits, then you get this result. And this result is statistically close to uniform. So actually, we are having a computational assumption here, which is the collision resistance. But the so we have a computational assumption, but the result is statistical one. And the reason is that actually we use the computational assumption to claim a combinatorial. I mean, the point here is that we take the collision resistance and say, okay, if it's a collision resistance like that, then it's also almost universal, which is a combinatorial thing, and then you get a statistical result. But the reason we say collision resistance and not delta AU is because you tell one of these people that in the standards we assume delta almost universal, and they say, oh, wow, that's probably something very deep. but I don't understand. But if you say collision resistance against weak attackers, then that sounds better. But so actually, if you did this truncation, you get actually a very strong result with no ideal assumptions, no random oracle, no random functions. Okay, I have time until when? Six? Yep. How many people are still not sleeping here? Okay, how many people know what HMAC is? How many people can write the HMAC formula now? Wow. We did something in this. It was worth coming from New York, leaving my beloved Trump behind. Okay, so wow, before I went too slow, now I'm going too fast. But so okay, so this HKDF is being accepted to many to many standards. So I mean, yeah. So it's something that. In TLS 1.0, which was an upgrade from SSL v3, I worked a little bit, not too much. I don't want to take credit for a terrible protocol, but I had a great achievement. I mean, I think it's my greatest achievement as a cryptographer is that the acronym PRF is in the standard. If you read the TLS RFC, there is a PRF, okay, and that's mine. I mean, that is my my theoretical contribution to TLS. And now I have to be even more proud because now the word extract is part of the standard. So anyway, so this is really gaining acceptance as a multi-purpose function. And let me show you why this is a good thing. Yeah, bonus achievement, word extract made it to standards. But let me show you this example of TLS 1.3 and how these all different properties of HMAC as an extractor, random oracle, PRF, collision resistant, all of them are being used in a very compact protocol. Now, there is TLS 1.3 asterisk because this is not TLS 1.3, unfortunately. This was a previous version of TLS 1.3. First of all, I had this written in a previous talk, so I had to take but I'll show, after show, in some way, this example is even better than the one I have now, but I'll show you after that exactly an application to TLS 1.3 the way it is defined. But let's start with this one. So, you know, TLS is, most of the time is used as a server-only authenticator. Only the server authenticates, not the client. There is an option of the client authenticating, but for the sake of this example, it's enough to look at the server authenticating. And of course, this is a very schematic representation only of the elements that I need in order to show the example. So the client, they do a Diffie-Hellman. So the client sends G to the X, and the server sends the server in this case has a public key which is a Diffie-Hellman public key. So it has a secret S and a public key G to the S. So the server sends a G to the Y for the Diffie-Hellman, the ephemeral Diffie-Hellman, send a certificate that shows that G to the S is the key, and a MAC in which it takes a key derived. It MACs G to the X and G to the Y with some MAC key, which is not important for the example, so let's not say how that is done. But at the end, they derive a session key from two values, g to the xs and g to the xy. So g to the xs is computed by the server as g to the x to the power of s, And it's computed by the client as g to the s, the public key, to the power of x. And also g to the xy as the ephemeral Diffie-Hellman that they compute from these two values. Okay? So the session key is derived from this and from this. Okay? And it's derived using HKDF. So it looks like this. They derive a key. They first derive a key from the combination of g to the x and g to the s. We will call it KXS. And they do that using HKDF with a salt value of 0. Then they take g to the xy, and they derive a key KXY as the HKDF with salt of 0 and input g to the xy. Finally, they take these two things, KXS and KXY, and derive using HKDF the session key. Now, in this case, KXS is being used as the salt value and KXY as the input value. And this is supposed to be secure as long as one of these two keys are unexposed. So the forward secrecy is the case in which this thing is exposed. You know, the secret key of the server is found. So the attacker knows S, it can compute this, but it cannot compute that. That's what's called forward secrecy. And if g to the xy is actually exposed because, you know, the x was not kept secret enough, and this is, well, x, no, that's not a good one. If y was not kept secure enough, then this will save you. Anyway, the point is that you need both keys in order to get the session key. So let's see what is the functionality of each one of these elements. So here we are using HKDF or HMAC with a key of 0, which is implementing a random oracle. Why do we need a random oracle here? Because in the proof, you know, to extract this key from g to the xs, forget about HMAC, HKDF, or whatever, the proof requires that this will be a random oracle. Okay, this if you know DHIES, Diffie-Hellman something, my goodness, what encryption system? Anyway, this is basically this is exactly the receiver has g to the s, you send g to the x, and you derive the key as g to the xs, okay? But you derive it with a random oracle. You need random oracle in order for this thing to be CCA secure, okay? This, at least in this case, is, I don't remember the acronyms of the name of this construction. I will tell you who the authors are. This is Abdallah, Belare, and Rogaway. You see, half of it I. So anyway, so here you need a random oracle because independently of this mechanism, because you need it for CCA security. And here we are using the fact that we can prove that this thing is actually a random oracle if the compression function is a random oracle. Here we are using, this is only an extract functionality. Unfortunately, there are no, I don't have salt here to use. And as I said, we could use the nonces that are not shown here, but the parties exchanged nonces. We could have used the nonces as salt. Unfortunately, the protocol does not authenticate this salt before we need to use it. And if we don't have authenticated salt, it means that the attacker can choose the salt. It means that it can choose a seed after seeing the source distribution, and we don't like that, so we use that with an H, okay, with a zero. Now, look, you know, we wanted to have the property that if g to the xs is not compromised, then this thing is secure. So what property are we going to use here? If g to the xs is not compromised, then kxs is a secret key. And in this case, HKDF will get a secret key and will get security out of HMAC as a PRF. Okay? If KXS is not compromised, it's a secret key, then we just use HMAC as a PRF because this is not just public salt, it's secret salt, and we can use it as a PRF. If G to the XS is actually eventually compromised, which is the forward secrecy case, then we have HKDF again with KXS, but look, in this case, KXS is public, but it's still uniform because it was at the time that it was chosen by the honest parties. It only happened later that S was compromised. So this exactly works as a random but non-secret value. But that is enough for this thing to work as an extractor, OK? So again, in this case, we are using it as a PRF. Ah, beautiful. In this case, we are using it as a random oracle because the proof of DHIES requires that for CCI security. Here, we're using it as a PRF. Here, we are using it as an extractor. So you see, in one little piece of this protocol, we actually are using all these properties that we claim. And I wrote there minimizing the use of ROM. You know, there is a philosophical thing. If in your protocol there is any element that uses something as a random oracle, why bother? Let's do it all with the random oracle. That's one approach. One approach is this, no, let's use it only where it's really required. Of course, I am on the side of saying, let's minimize it for two reasons. One is because we want to know for every element in the protocol what is necessary, what is sufficient, but also because these protocols then change or they are used in different ways. And there are some cases where, for example, this random oracle will not be needed. I think that in the next slide, we will not need a random oracle here. But anyway, so that's to show you that all these elements come together in this nice way. Now, why salt? Because we don't have authenticated randomness. This one I wanted to say. HMAC as a random oracle has some subtleties I said about the keys. Okay, so the point here that I was making is that I didn't know about that subtlety when I defined HKDF. Actually, I used the fact that HMAC is a random oracle when the keys are not chosen adversarially, because either they are chosen by the honest parties or they are set to zero. But anyway, but because theory says that you are not supposed to choose seeds, I think I said that. I'm repeating myself. This is my age. Yeah. So since you are not supposed to choose seeds after seeing the source, then really I had this requirement to either have them random and chosen by the honest guys or zero. And again, even though I didn't have an attack or I didn't know if really there is an attack or not, you know, following the theory is a very good advisor for avoiding surprises in the future. Okay, now, yes, I just want to tell you, as I said, that the example before is not what goes now in TLS 1.3. That G to the S by the server is not there anymore. Now the server signs things instead of doing it with G to the XS. But there is something called resumption mode, which basically is a case in which the client and the server exchanged the key in the past, and now they are resuming the session or starting a new session with a key that they cached. So you use that key, and now everything is the same as I showed before, except for the G to the XS. But in the point that the key, if not compromised, gives you a PRF, and if it is eventually compromised, it works as an extractor, is exactly as I showed before, and this is really applies to the real TLS 1.3. Now, it's interesting, again, that as a key derivation, I never thought that you need collision resistance for key derivation, because you don't have a situation in which someone can choose two inputs that can collide. We use collision resistance to justify some of the extraction properties, okay, but just to show some combinatorial property that these functions need to have. But that the output is collision resistant was not needed in any of the applications that I had in mind. Now it happens that in TLS 1.3, I will not get into the details of how this happens, but basically they are using some keys as, you know, so you, client and server never talk to each other, so they talk for the first time and they exchange a key. They cache the key for use in the future, okay? So that's a typical use. Now, the key that they cache for the future actually needs to be bound to the parameters of the first session where they exchange the key. So it needs to be bound to the identities of the parties, maybe to a certificate that the server sent, to some negotiation of cryptographic algorithms that they will apply to the session, all kinds of things. And they use these keys not only as a key for whatever MAC encryption, but they also use it to bind these to the history. Now, when you use a string as a binder, actually you require collision resistance. Because, you know, I exchange a key in the past with the server, so there is an issue with key exchange that, you know, in key exchange protocols, the only assurance you give to keys is that if you exchange the key with an honest party, then when that key is secure. If you exchange that key with a not honest party, our models don't assure anything about that key. In particular, the attacker if I exchange a key with an attacker, and the attacker exchanges key with someone else, it can exchange the same key. Okay, so there can be collisions on the keys. For key exchange, that's not a problem. For this application, it is a problem. And here, actually, in order to avoid that, you need the key derivation function to also be collision resistant. Of course, this is something that HMAC or HKDF does well, because it inherits collision resistant in quite straightforward way from the hash functions. So that's another property that in TLS 1.3 is also used. Okay, what do I want to do? I have 25 minutes. Let's see. I want to do something else. So, you know what? Actually, I have some. Okay, this I don't want to do. Okay, I my philosophical thing, okay? So it's not about theory versus practice in the sense of this against this. Should I do theory? Should I do practice? There is a very interesting dynamic interaction between theory and practice. Particularly in cryptography, it's a balancing act in the sense that, you know, we always try to push more on the side of the theory. Then the practitioners come and they say no, and they say okay, I will change things a little bit, but you know, don't force me too much. I mean, it's a negotiation with life. And 20 years ago, believe me, it was hard to deal with these things. Today, we get much more respect thanks to the fact that, you know, you see that designs that were not done with some good theoretical basis usually break over time. So now we get a little bit more of respect. Now, theory is not a panacea. It's not that if you follow theory, everything is perfect. Nothing, no proof is better than the model which is based on, okay? And if the models cover more or less of the actual practical, you know, what can be a practical attack or not, so we cannot exaggerate too much on just saying, you know, because I have a proof that when the compression function is a random family, then, I mean, you know, we have to understand what we are getting, but also the limitation of the things. But of course, I mean, I don't have to tell you that, but I'll tell you that anyway. crypto without theoretical analysis has no value. There is no empirical evidence that the cryptographic scheme is secure. There is this quantifier, universal quantifier, which says for all adversaries. And for all adversaries means you cannot model all adversaries other than mathematically. So, any time that someone argues with you about the importance of proofs and theory in cryptography, you tell them that. Universal quantifiers, okay? It's not about making something faster and showing that it's faster. Now, cryptography has been amazingly successful in having practical use of the concepts and methods, both the formalization of things, some basic primitives. Most of the crypto that we do, unfortunately, is not used. Most of it will never be used because we do too much. There's not enough applications. But in the sense of building functionality and putting it to work in the real world, we have not been very successful. I hope that this new generation will see better or more uses of sophisticated cryptography. But in the meantime, you know, when you come even to analyze these kind of things, everything, you know, simulations, indistinguishability, extraction, all these abstractions are unbelievably useful. And a little bit of advertisement, need more involvement of researchers with practice. I mean, do not complain later, these practitioners don't know what they are doing. So definitely don't leave theory, but at the same time, pay attention to this kind of thing. So that's a philosophical speech. Now, I need to have some discussion with myself. I wanted very much to do something here, but I need to see if with this time, if it's enough to make something. You know, I'll tell you about this. You know, I'll not show you in details, but I mean it's a fun application. You know that, yeah. Basically, the first part are things that Evgeny covered in his talk, but as I learned some time ago, you know, never underestimate the power of repetition. And I take it so seriously that I repeat again and again that idiom, never underestimate the power of repetition. So anyway, leftover hash lemma, we all know what the leftover hash lemma says. The only thing that I care about in this for this thing is is that let's Yeah, okay, so this is already, okay. So we start with a source with mean entropy m, okay? And we want to produce k bits of output. okay, let's see this, how bad this is. K here is, k here is the seed, basically. So let's call the output n. Oh, actually it's here. Okay, I couldn't find that. So k now is the seed, is what before was something else. But now it's the key to the hash function for the leftover hash lemma. So k is the seed that is being output, and we are interested to have things, an extractor that is close to uniform. And the leftover hash lemma says that any source and for any extractor, you must lose at least you need to have enough entropy so that the difference between entropy and the output that you want to produce is L. Okay, let me start again. Let's call L the difference between the mean entropy that you have in the source and the number of bits that you want to output. Then the leftover hash lemma says that you must have a loss. The distance has to be two to the minus the difference L divided by two. So this is something you can achieve with for example, pairwise universal hash functions. But also there is a theorem which should be somewhere here that says that this is optimal. I mean, this is something that you can achieve, but also something that whatever way you build your extractor, you are going to lose that. I mean, you are going to be bound by this thing. Okay, so you need to. Let me go to some numerical example. Okay, so for application to key derivation. So let's say that you have an elliptic curve group of 160 bits, and you need to derive a 128-bit ES key. What this thing says is that if you are going to take this elliptic curve group, which we assume is DDH, and you are going to extract 128 bits, then the best security you can expect is half of the difference 32, so it's 2 to the minus 16, okay, which is not very good. If you have a 256-bit, you derive 160-bit, then you get an epsilon, which is 2 to the minus 48, and you cannot do better if the way in which you extract uses the leftover hash lemma, and also with no other extractor, because there is the RT bound that, of course, I will not tell you who the sources are. Ramachandran, right? Radhakrishnan. You see? And Tashma. Okay, Tashma, I got it right. Okay, so we must have 2 to the minus L over 2 security degradation. However, what I think Evgeny told you, I wasn't here, but is that loss on security is unavoidable if you want to have a general thing. But if you want to apply to a setting, cryptographic setting, for example, a setting in which you have a MAC application. So how do you break a MAC? By guessing the tag of a message that was not queried from the MAC function, right? So it's a predictability issue. You need to predict to guess what the value is. In that case, what we know is that the attacker has very tiny probability of guessing the thing, which means that actually the set of keys, of MAC keys, in which the attacker has some significant probability of success is very, very tiny. And intuitively, you know, for these extractors that actually, you know, spread the input points into outputs in some uniform way, then you don't expect that these 2 to the minus L over 2 that must be there will all fall on these tiny sets where the attacker has some good probability of success. Okay, so that's the intuition. But what can be shown that actually, if you look at it like that, then if you start with an application where the attacker has probability epsilon on uniform n-bit inputs, meaning these are the keys to the MAC, okay, then the leftover hash lemma will tell you that the attacker, if you now choose the keys using the hash functions or whatever, then now the attacker can have this probability. I mean, the probability increased by this value, which is not that good. You know, it will give you the 2 to the minus 16 probability, 2 to the minus 48. But in the case in which the attacker has this tiny set where it succeeds, you can actually show that it's better than that. You can act, basically what this means is that you can borrow security in the statistical distance, you can borrow from the security of your underlying cryptographic primitive. So okay, so it means security degradation of this value instead of 2 to the minus L over 2. And let me show you some numerical examples. So for example, if I showed this example before in which from 160 to 128, let's say that is to derive an AES key, which has, let's assume that AES has an epsilon of 2 to the minus 96. So the leftover hash lemma would lower it to 2 to the minus 16, but with this generalized leftover hash lemma, you get security of 2 to the minus 64, which is not the original 2 to the minus 96, but something much better than this. If you go from 256 to 160, where the SHA-1 has an epsilon of 2 to the minus 80, the leftover hash lemma will give you 2 to the minus 48. The generalized leftover hash lemma will give you this. So you go back basically to the, you are not losing real security in this case. And it gets even better, you can gain entropy. Okay, if you go from elliptic curve 160 bits to 250 bit HMAC, SHA-2, like as a MAC function, and you assume that the epsilon, the security of 256-bit HMAC is 2 to the minus 200, then the security with the extracted keys is 2 to the minus 52. Here, epsilon, square root epsilon, comes here. That gives you the 200 original divided by 2. Times this part, 2 to the minus L over 2. Anyway, these things gave you 2 to the minus 52. So even though you expanded, actually, the input with the mean entropy into something longer, actually, you're still OK because the security of the primitive, of the cryptographic primitive, help you compensate for the loss that comes from the extractor part. Now, this is for things like unpredictability, you know, a MAC, inverting a function, doing a key retrieval, things like that, where the attacker has very small probability of success. Now, if we go to undistinguishability, okay, we want to, you know, break an encryption by distinguishing the output, you know, by, you know, giving two messages and guessing which of the messages was encrypted. Here, the attacker has a huge probability. I mean, he has half plus epsilon, right? So it's not a tiny thing, it's a big thing. So it turns out, so you can ask the question whether for these applications we can also enjoy that borrowing of security from the underlying primitive, and the answer is that, okay, so can we do something in this case? So the negative answer is no, we cannot. We cannot do one-time paths, pseudo-random functions, pseudo-random generators. They cannot benefit from this generalized thing. In what sense? In the sense that I can show you examples of all, each one of the things where an attack that will show that you cannot really improve. Okay. There is some characterization of the things. I will, fortunately, of course, otherwise I wouldn't say anything here. Fortunately, it does work in some cases. And the characterization of what are the cases that it works in situations where, you know, we are talking about indistinguishability. So the output of the attacker is a bit. Right? There is a challenger that chooses some experiment under some random bit, and the attacker needs to guess the bit. Okay? And the probability is half plus something. So if you are in a situation where the attacker, you run the attacker, whatever it is, it outputs a bit, b. But now, before outputting the bit, you do the following. Simulate the challenger, okay? For example, if you are doing an encryption function, so you can. What does the challenger do? The attacker chooses M1, M2. The challenger chooses one at random, encrypts it, and see if the attacker can guess. Now, what you are going to do, you are now working with the attacker, saying to the attacker, wait with your bit B, I will test you. Let's run another run, okay, in which you give me M1 and M2, and I will answer for you, and I'll see if you know the answer. Since I'm choosing the M1 or the M2, I know if the attacker, the second time, he was right or not. So any setting which allows the attacker to check itself to see if he's having success or not success with the experiment, if you can do that, then you can actually any application where you can do this self-check actually can enjoy the generalized leftover hash lemma with the square root of epsilon, as we saw before. And that includes encryption functions, public key, and symmetric key. And actually, you know, okay, so here is the bad news in all this story. The bad news is that you cannot pseudo-random function or pseudo-random generators. Now, what I would have liked to do is to have a key derivation function using the leftover hash lemma, okay, with real extractors. And I would like to improve the security of the output using something like this. Unfortunately, if I will use the left, I will use some extractor from my source to get a key and now derive more keys, the way I would do that is I would take that key, use it with a pseudo-random function, and get some other keys. Unfortunately, if I use the output of the extractor with a PRF, this doesn't work. Okay, I don't gain the thing. So that's the bad news. So not applicable to general KDFs. But wait, not all is lost. Okay, this good news applies to weak PRFs. What is a weak PRF? A weak PRF is a PRF that is secure when all the attacker can see is the result of the function on random values. Okay? So actually, it's a weaker notion than a PRF. But now, because we have weak PRFs that do enjoy the generalized leftover hash lemma, then here is a way to do a KDF, okay? I have my source, M entropy source, and I have an extractor that works with that source. output in k bits. Now, the inputs to the KDF are the sample from the source X, a random seed for the extractor, whatever the extractor is, but also a random input to the WPRF. And my KDF will work like this. We'll get the sample X, the seed S for the extractor, the input W to the WPRF. And that's the way I will compute the key is by looking at the seed as the pair SW, using the extractor with S in the regular way to get a key, using that key to key the WPRF on the random bit, random input W that is part of my seed, and that will be my key. Okay? So I took the extractor, I did everything as before. I took the extractor, got a key, used the key with the WPRF, but I also, as part of my seed, I choose a random input to the WPRF, and now I actually can get all the benefits of the generalized leftover hash lemma on this derivation, because for WPRFs, it's one of the cases where the generalized LHL actually works. Okay. Now, after I outputted key, if I want more keys, then I'm fine. Now I can use key. They use the key K as a PRF, as a PRF key. Now I am free of using whatever I want, because the guarantee that I got here is that the output from here is away from uniform by, you know, the epsilon half, square root epsilon times 2 to the minus L over 2. For a WPRF? Because in WPRF, you can play that game. You can play the game in, because you know, the real game is that the attacker queries the function, okay? Let's say it queries only one time and then decides. So it queries the function, the challenger returns either a random value or the output of the PRF. The attacker think, say, okay, the bit is zero. And now I stop and say, okay, you know what? Let's play the game again. I'll give you the value of the PRF on another input, okay? And now I'm in this simulated challenger, and okay, that will I will choose whether to give him either the real value of the second sample or of a random one. And now I play with the adversary. Now what we do is that if the second time the adversary that was right, then I will output the original bit B. If the second time it was wrong, I will output the reverse bit. And it's a beautiful thing that, if we had more time, I could definitely convince you that if you run these multiple times, then you are approximating the success probability. But even only one time is already to give you this result.
Just to tell us what you're getting on Monday, this is because we care about the square friend.
Yeah, it's, yeah. Yes, okay.
So if you want to have Google buzzwords, those are the buzzwords you can do there.
Yes, I mean, square friendly clearly describes this thing, right? Anyway, so I'll finish this. I'll tell you what I didn't do, and I will leave with that, is that We now have a key derivation function that enjoys the benefits of the generalized leftover hash lemma. But what we didn't solve, at least at the practical level, is what we said is now we are going to apply a regular extractor, and then they use the WPRF, and we are done. For the regular extractor, at least for the simple ones, universal hash functions, the salt is long, is as long as the message. So you want to say, okay, how can we reduce it? So there are theoretical constructions of extractors that will use less salt, but as I said before, it would be interesting to find things like that will also be very practical. But if we want to use universal hash functions, which are very simple, then what we could do is to start with a small short seed and run a PRG on the short seed, now get a long seed, and use that long seed as your, you know, the seed to your universal hash function. But the point is now that you will outputting S, the seed to the PRG, okay? So the question is, if I give you the output of a PRG together with the seed, okay, how secure is the thing? So we are going back to something very similar to what happened with using HMAC with a non-secret key. Again, I said there that PRFs with a non-secret key are not secure, but in order to be non-secure, you have to use things like public key, you know, quadratic residue, DDH, blah, blah, blah. Here is exactly the same thing. Actually, we can prove that in Minikrypt, Minikrypt is a world where there are one-way functions, but there is no public key cryptography. In Minikrypt, if you do that, you expand the seed with a pseudo-random generator, then and you build the extractor with the known seed for the PRG, it's secure, okay? How do we do that? We show that if there is a distinguisher against that, then we can build a public key scheme out of that distinguisher. If you don't believe that we live, no, actually we don't believe, right? We don't believe that we live in Minikrypt. We believe that we do have public key. But the other way of looking at this result is, since the PRG can be built with something like AES, then this result means if you can break the extractor built in this way, then we can build a public key system based only on AES. And since we don't believe that that's possible, then maybe that's enough evidence for this to be secure. It's kind of cheating because the distinguisher can be very complicated. So it's not that, you know, you get something as simple as AES. But there, anyway, I think that it's interesting to see these variations of the same issue that we had with PRS with non-secret seed.
So we know how to build public key encryption from
AES? No. What the claim is that if you can show me a distinguisher for that construction of an extractor, where the seed is the public seed is S, but the seed that you use for the extractor is the longer one stretched with the PRG. If you can break that construction, give me a distinguisher, I will build a public key based on your distinguisher, which is, I will build the public key using AES and your distinguisher.
You use the forbidden word. If you have indistinguishable obfuscation, then you can build public key encryption from AES.
Yeah, of course. It goes without saying that. and it will be very simple too. Yeah. Anyway, I kept you enough. Thank you very much. By the way, since I'm leaving tonight, actually, I wanted to thank very much the organizers, everyone from the committee for inviting me, definitely the people, the local people, Carla Jessica and Joanna and also the young ones. Sorry, you are young too. Zaira, no? Antonio. Anyway, everyone really. It was one of the best schools I participated, at least before my talk. So for them. Okay, whoever wants to stay can ask questions. Other people can leave because, what time is it? Oh, it's not so bad. Yeah.
Does the computational analog have the computational almost universal hash function? Do you get computational distinguishability?
Yes. You get if you start from computation. Yeah. Yes. 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 But you know, with computational extractors, the limits of the leftover hash lemma don't apply. Computational extractor, I can extract whatever and then stretch it to anything I want with a PRG.
But a very simple, like it's a weaker result than what you showed, I think, but a very simple way of showing that HMAX is a KDF, isn't it just to say that it's a PRF, and a PRF is a computational universal hash function? Or, okay, yeah. And then applying computational leftover hash lemma.
So you say that a PRF is necessarily what? Almost universal?
Yeah.
Is that true?
If it's long enough, if the output is long enough?
Wait, but with the secret seed or with the... No, right.
And in the universal game, you don't see the key either. If you see it as a game.
So if again, if you're if you use a secret seed, a secret key, then the PRF is indistinguished from a random function, and anything that happens with random function will.
Yeah. I mean, you don't not as strong, but you probably can show the computational one where you don't see the seed.
Oh, the non-strong.
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
Does that follow that argument? Like as a simple way of showing that HMAC is a KDF?
Again, HMAC. Wait. But you don't have a secret key in the. If you have a secret key, then HMAC as a PRF gives you all these goodies. With a secret seed, with a secret seed, or with?
Like we, not the strong version of them.
Right, so with secret seed.
Secret seed, yeah.
Okay.
And then, if the weak version of the leftover hash lemma holds, then it should be an extractor, right?
What's not clear to me is how are you going to use HMAC with a secret seed in the extraction applications? If you can afford a secret seed, HMAC is a PRF, and basically it outputs indistinct pseudo-random values, and you are okay. You don't need any extraction beyond that. If the key is secret, but if the key is not secret, then you are.
There's some hole in the logic there.
There is what? No, not necessarily fixed. It can be fixed or it can be a salt, you know, a random. I mean,
if it's random, it should hold, right?
If it's random but public, okay, then you don't get anything directly from being a PRF. Okay? A PRF with a public key, with a non-secret key, it can be completely insecure. Which universe?
In the game for a universal hash function, the adversary chooses the input, and then you get to see the key, right? So by PRF security, it should hold.
No. In the universal hash, it's a combinatorial property. There is no attacker, okay? It says that for any pair of inputs, the number of functions that will send these two inputs to the same value is small. You can see that as a game. Yeah, the game is the attacker gives you a pair.
Yeah.
You choose a key and you see if it collides or not.
I think I get your intuition, but the parameters you would get not interesting. Yeah. You don't get any interesting result. Like it's trivial. Basically, you will not be able to, if you then apply the leftover headcount, you don't get any interesting results. Because it's like the parameter you would need for the delta AUA, the delta that you get. I don't think you can any like you can derive anything from that delta.
I think that I'm not sure exactly. I still don't get exactly where you're going with this. But one thing I can tell you is that PRFs are excellent weak extractors. Okay, because in a weak extractor situation, you don't publish the seed. You don't have to be close to uniform condition on the seed. And of course, PRFs are excellent weak computational extractors. That's for sure. So that part we can agree with. I hope that you agree with that too.
No.
Okay, good.
It's a modeling question about random oracles. So if I understand correctly, the Q times 2 to the minus M computational extractor.
Mm-hmm. I mean, you can relax that in this case.
So I guess my question was, in sort of philosophically, when you think about modeling random oracle and for practical application, does the distinction between these two models matter or not really? One shouldn't worry about arbitrary non-uniform advice that depends arbitrarily on the entire random oracle.
All I can say is that the stronger the model or the weaker the attacker, the better. And not just because, of course, it's better to be beautiful and rich than ugly and poor, but also because really in these applications, you actually find a range of situations where, in the case of the random oracle, since the best strategy for that attacker is just to choose the heaviest elements in the distribution, so in particular it's a non-adaptive strategy, then actually you can let the attacker query its Q queries, and the rest of it, the attacker can choose in any way he wants, respecting the m-bit entropy. So that's the weakest form of independence that you can actually ask for in this case. Essentially, what this means is that with random oracles, for example, the basic claim, probably the way it's written in the papers, is that you assume the random oracle to be independent of the source. Now, in practice, your random oracle is based on some hash, SHA-2, and probably the input also is, the source is also based on SHA-2, because, even the Diffie-Hellman, how did you choose the exponents of the Diffie-Hellman? You hash something with SHA. So to say that these things are independent, actually, it's quite a stretch. But the situation is not that bad, because really all the independence you want is that those exponents that were chosen using SHA-2, where they apply SHA-2 on something different than what you're applying from your source. So, you know, in the random oracle, as long as you don't ask that particular point, then you are okay. But the bottom line of all this discussion is that it shows how important it is to use a kid random oracle. You know, at least if you use the same SHAB, at least use it with different, with independent keys. So from a practical point of view, I think that that's an important point to make.
You mentioned that HKDF is not indifferentiable from random oracle because of the attack.
So HMAC is indifferentiable from random oracle under some constraints on the keys. As I said, you can think about that there are some set of weak keys, okay? Like, you know, usually in cryptography we have weak keys for encryption, a subset of keys that if you choose from them, something can go wrong. So in that sense, you can think of HMAC being indifferentiable from random oracle with a set of weak keys. Now, this is exploitable only in settings where the attacker can choose the keys. Okay, if the keys are chosen at random or they are fixed to zero or something like that, you don't have a problem. In a setting where the attacker can choose the keys and can choose them variable lengths and all kind of other constraints, then you have an issue. But the bottom line, as a result, it means that really, you can prove the indifferentiability of the thing, except for this set of wikis, which are well defined and don't really come up in practice and in all applications I know. But it's actually very nice that the work that, as you can imagine, I'm not going to say who the authors are. Evgeny is here, so I will not say. Because, you know, if he was here, I had to say that he was one of the co-authors. So it's very nice that when they were trying to prove the indifferentiability, actually they found the things which are very, very non-intuitive. Particularly if you use, instead of a family of random oracles, you use it as a single function, then it's perfectly indifferentiable. More questions? Okay, who wants to come and write HKDF, definition of HKDF? Okay, I think you had enough of me. Thank you very much.